Everybody said? Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, whether you're here in this room, watching online, or joining by television. It is such an honor and privilege to worship with you all today. And as Governor mentioned, Dr. Cross and his wife are traveling. And so for the next couple moments, I have the honor and privilege of getting to share from God's Word with you. I'm so grateful for the influence of Dr. Cross in my life. We've been on the church staff. I've served under his leadership now for about 12 years, which is longer than I care to remember, but about 12 years, and he's been my pastor, a leader, a mentor in my life for many more than that. I'm so grateful for his leadership and just for the opportunity to share with you all today, to be up here and to look at what God, the message that God has for us. And so today, we are going to jump in to Leviticus chapter 6. Now, I know what you're thinking. Leviticus? That's right. That's the third book in the Bible. It's the one that, you know, a lot of people in their New Year's resolution reading plan, Leviticus is the one that they drop out on. Well, maybe not you, but for me, I know it has for me sometimes. And so you've got Genesis, action, act, creation, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. You've got the family drama. It's basically a soap opera. And then you slide right into Exodus. You've got Moses, this legendary leader. You've got the escape from Egypt. You've got the Red Sea and the miracles. And then it's basically the script of an action movie. And then you come to Leviticus. And so today, we are going to look in Leviticus. I promise you, I tried to choose something else in regards to the message for today, but God just kept bringing me back here. So if nothing else, maybe today will be a message for me. But I hope that you are encouraged by what God has got for us in this passage. But Leviticus is essentially where God kind of establishes the sacrificial system. You see, we as humans and us and the people of this book, we're sinners. I hate to break it to you, newsflash. We're not perfect, right? And so therefore we create a separation from God. God is holy, we are not. So therefore we are separated because of our sin. And so God needed a way to atone for that sin, to essentially create a way that we could have a relationship with him, that we could be made holy, whole again. So he created the sacrificial system, basically. The Israelites, when they sinned, when it was the time, they would bring sacrifices and they would be burnt on an altar, and that would essentially provide forgiveness for them. And the reason that I think is really important for us to talk about this passage today is because without the sacrificial system, without understanding what happened before, it's difficult for us to fully grasp and fully understand the depth of what Jesus did for us and his work on the cross. You see, he came and gave his life. We'll talk a little bit more about this in a moment. But he came and gave his life as the ultimate sacrifice, fulfilling, completing that need for sacrifice. And so he provided a way for us to have a relationship with him. So we're going to jump into Leviticus chapter 6. Thank you for joining me on this journey today. We're going to start in verse number 8. The Lord said to Moses, "Give Aaron and his sons this command. These are the regulations for the burnt offering. The burnt offering is to remain on the altar hearth throughout the night until morning, and the fire must be kept burning on the altar." Remember that part. We're going to skip down to verse 12. "The fire on the altar must be kept burning. It must not go out. Every morning the priest is to add firewood and arrange the burnt offering on the fire and burn the fat of the fellowship offerings on it." The fire must be kept burning on the altar continuously. It must not go out. I think it's pretty clear the message that God is trying to tell us this morning. But before we jump into it, is anybody like an avid camper? You love camping? Okay, no. If you're joining us online and you love camping, just type in the chat your favorite place to go camping. Well, like you, I don't know that I would say my family and I are really big campers either. But one of the mainstays of a good camping trip is the campfire. It kind of serves as the centerpiece, the gathering point of your campsite. When you go camping, you sit around the campfire and you talk, you chat, you share stories. Maybe you roast some marshmallows. Maybe if you're super adventurous, you actually cook food on the fire. Good for you, if that's you. But I don't really have a ton of camping stories, but it did bring to mind this one story of a birthday that I had. My birthday is in October. That means we are exactly 2 months to the day, in case you were wondering what my birthday is. 2 months to the day. And in October, my wife surprised me with a trip to North Carolina. It was beautiful this time of year, in October, right? There's basically a famous painting that you can see God painted, and the trees, the leaves were so many different colors. The place we stayed was a cabin, essentially, on the side of a mountain. It had a stream rolling down the driveway. It was basically a postcard in real life, where you take, like, the setting of a Hallmark movie, and that's where we were. And so when we got there to North Carolina, again, it's in October, and we're Florida people, and so that night, the temperature was supposed to be about 20 degrees. Yeah. That chill that just went through the room right now, that's what I was thinking. So we get there, and we're like, you know, this is exciting, this is fun, you know. And my wife, Courtney, she looks at me, and she goes, you know, honey, I think it'd be really fun if we built a fire, and we cooked some marshmallows, and we made some s'mores. And I thought to myself, well, my beautiful, lovely wife, do you know how cold 20 degrees is outside? But, being the knight in shining armor that I am, I decided I'm going to put my man hat on, and I'm going to build us a fire. I'm not, like, totally un-outdoorsy, so I do have a little bit of an idea of how to build a fire. So I made a teepee, if you know what building a fire is. And so I made my teepee, and I tried to put some little sticks under it. And unlike the people in the Leviticus days, I got to cheat and have a lighter. And so I started lighting the little kindling in there, and it would kind of, you know, spark up a little bit, kind of start burning a little bit, and then it would just kind of fizzle out. It was frustrating. Right? So I would, okay, maybe I forgot this. So I go and try something else, and I put something else in the fire, and it would kind of start up a little bit, and then it would fizzle out. And then I got the bright idea, I'm going to try some lighter fluid. So I went and grabbed some lighter fluid, squirted it all on there. Basically, an inferno comes up, right? But then what happens? It goes right back out again. And so every time I would get it going, I would think, and I would run inside me, honey, we're ready, it's time, let's go. And I would look outside as we're ready to walk back out, and this thing is just kind of flopped and a little glowing orange. For 2 hours, I spent trying to get this fire stoked, trying to get it to keep going. And I did eventually get it going, and I think we spent all of 4 minutes outside. We roasted one marshmallow. By the time we got there, I was like, okay, this isn't really fun anymore. 20 degrees is cold. Let's go back inside. We'll make some marshmallows in the microwave. But as I was thinking about this passage, that story came to mind, and it really isn't that a pretty good example of the Christian life? Where God comes in, we accept Jesus into our life. And if you're here today or joining us, and you've yet to make that decision, we're going to tell you a little bit more about that and give you an opportunity to do that a little bit later on. But God lights that fire in our hearts. Pretty much the rest of our life is spent making decisions that are either going to fan our flame or move towards diminishing the flame. The Bible is very clear. The altar must be kept burning. The fire must be kept burning. Everybody say, keep it burning. We've got to keep it burning. Now, it's important, as Dr. Cross teaches us, if the Bible says it, we should listen. Pretty flat out, right? But if the Bible says it twice, that's like a, hey, buddy, listen up, let me get your attention. In this instance, the Bible says it 3 different times in the context of the same passage. It's important. It was a big importance. And so you think about it like this. This is not a blog that you're just typing. It's not an email that you're sending. This isn't a Word document that you can just type up and hit print, and it'll print whatever you type. No, this is back in the day. This was most likely written on like a papyrus, which is an early form of paper, was not readily available. Not everybody in this day knew how to write. This was a limited resource. And so the fact that the author of this put it in here was chosen, and it was intentional, and it was important that the fire not go out. It must be kept burning continuously. Can I brag on you for a minute, church? For over 121 years, you have continually stoked the fire. I can promise you this, you don't get to be as a church over 120 years old without men and women who are willing to go above and beyond and allow God to use them, to use you, to stoke the fire in His house, to do whatever it takes to make Christ known, to walk in faith, to stoke the momentum that God has brought to our house. Can we take a moment and celebrate those who have made that effort? We have a long legacy, a long history of people willing to stoke the fire, and I believe now is our turn. For those of us in this room who are joining us by whatever means, now is our turn to continue what they started, to continue the legacy that God is writing here in our church, to keep the fire burning. And now you may be thinking to yourself, okay, well, why, in this specific context, why was it so important to keep the fire lit? I mean, wouldn't it just be easier? Starting a fire is really not that hard. Wouldn't it just be easier to restart whenever they needed it? Well, as one commentator says, the reason it's so important is because God started the fire. If you fast forward to Leviticus chapter 9, it basically tells the story of the first worship experience using this method. And what happens is the presence of God is revealed, and His fire from His presence goes forth and consumes the offering. So why was it so important that the fire never go out? Because it had a touch of the divine. If the fire went out, it would no longer have the handprint of God. And so it was important for the priests to keep the fire burning. Even the Apostle Paul in the New Testament talks to his young protege Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6. He says, "For this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands." Church, a fire, I believe, has been lit. Now, the answer is no. I'm not going to start an actual fire here in the church. I'm pretty sure the fire department would frown upon that a little bit. However, I want to invite you to imagine with me for a moment that in this fire pit right here is a big blazing fire. Can you hear it? You hear the wood crackling. You smell the smoke, right? I believe God has lit a fire in our church. We have seen an amazing, amazing summer. We have had kids come to know Jesus and get baptized. We've seen students come to know Jesus and get baptized. We had two that we got to celebrate last week. We have more that will be coming up in the next couple of weeks. We've seen adults' lives change, eternities altered because of what God is doing through you. We've seen families dedicate their kids to say, "Hey, I want to raise my family in the name of Jesus." We've seen new people walk through our doors. We've seen new members join and become part of our family here. And I believe that God is challenging us as we embark into this new season to keep it burning. Everybody say, "Keep it burning." Type in the chat, "Keep it burning." We're walking into a new season. As Courtney mentioned, this is the last Sunday before school starts. Now, for those of you who don't have kids, you're like, "Eh, whatever." But those of you who do have kids, you're like, "Hallelujah." And so this is the last season. We're entering into a new season. And so also we've got our snowbirds, our seasonal members who are going to be returning. The seasonal members of our community that need Jesus will be coming back. We've got the holidays on the horizon. You see, God has started a fire. I believe He has a divine handprint on our church. And I believe that He is calling us to steward that fire. He is calling us to keep it going. You may be thinking to yourself, "Well, how do you keep a fire going?" Well, this is an easy one. You look in verse 12. You got to add firewood. So if you want to keep a fire going, you got to add some firewood. And so today, I thought we would take a few moments and talk about how we can throw some logs onto the fire. Throw some logs onto the fire. So the first log that we want to throw onto our fire to make sure it stays burning We've got to have constant praise. Everybody say praise. We've got to have constant praise because we have so much to praise God for. Everybody breathe in real deep with me. Ready? Breathe it out. Well, we just get to thank God for another breath in our lives. We get to thank God for the clothes that we have on, the shoes that we're wearing, the car that we most likely drove here in, the house that we probably left to come here, the food that we're going to leave here and go eat. We have so much to praise God for. The Bible says in Philippians 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Apparently repetition is a thing today. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, the idea of giving praise, God is doing some amazing things, has taken a whole new theme in our family lately. Courtney shared with you last week, but a couple Tuesdays ago, my son, Kaysen, he came to my wife and I and said, Mommy, Daddy, I want to invite Jesus into my heart. And as a parent, if you've experienced this before, you know, the moment he said that, my heart was jumping for joy. Wow, praise God, what an exciting time. And so I said, okay, bud, well, what does that mean? And I obviously want to make sure that he understands what that means. And so he said, for a couple moments, he just shared with me what it means to follow Jesus. He was a sinner. Jesus came and died on the cross to pay for those sins. And then basically I said, well, but do you want to do that? And he said, I'll do it tomorrow. But it was amazing to watch the Holy Spirit work in his young heart in that moment. Because he said, I'll do it tomorrow. Actually, I need to do it today. Actually, I need to do it right now. And we knelt, the three of us right there, laying on this little beanbag chair that we have upstairs in our house. And my son, Kaysen, prayed to receive Jesus. We have so much to praise God for. And here's the cool thing. I said, Kaysen, how old are you? I'm 6. I said, guess how old Daddy was when he invited Jesus into his life. That's right. When I was 6 years old, just like my son Kaysen, I can remember it like it was yesterday. I was sitting in a Sunday school class like the ones that are happening right now in First Kids. And there was a leader there who was one of the amazing volunteer teachers of this Sunday school. His name was Gary. Gary Schofield. He's in heaven now, but he was sharing about a train that was leaving the station, destination heaven. And he told me that, hey, you've got to have a ticket to get on the train, and that ticket is Jesus. And I decided right then and there, I want on that train. And I invited Jesus into my life, taking my ticket and getting ready when I leave this world to get ready to go to heaven. I don't know about you, but I am grateful for the Gary Schofields in my life that have decided to stoke the fire, that have been willing to say, hey, you know what? Not only am I going to grow my own self, but I'm going to invest into the life of others. I'm grateful for the people in First Kids right now who are teaching my kids about Jesus. We all get to play a part in the salvation story. So, church, thank you for stoking the fire in my family. Thank you for stoking the fire in our church family. Thank you for being used by God so other people can experience Jesus. Which leads us to the next log that we're going to throw on our fire. If we want it to keep burning, we got to keep adding logs, right? So, we're going to throw the log in the fire of constant passion. Everybody say passion. We've got to have constant passion. We've got to be passionate about telling people about Jesus. We've got to be passionate about inviting people to church. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 28, I hope you've heard this verse before, but therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I don't know, class, but that sounds a bit like a commandment to me. That's not a suggestion, that's a commandment. That's what we are called to do, that's what we are supposed to do. The result of that should light a fire in us, unlike anything else. Telling people about Jesus, sharing Jesus with people, should be our passion. I can remember to this day the first time I had the privilege of being a part of leading somebody to Jesus. It was at a kids' camp about a decade ago. And I got the privilege to lead one of those young boys to Jesus. Man, that fired me up. It still fires me up. It's exciting when we get to be a part of leading someone to Jesus. But here's the thing. The longer we serve Jesus, oftentimes the smaller the circle of our lost friends becomes. The longer we serve Jesus, oftentimes the smaller our lost community becomes. Now, don't mishear me. I'm not saying you should not surround yourself with people who follow Jesus. That is how we should be. The people who have influence on our lives should be people who follow Jesus, those closest to us. However, we need to still be in the world. That's why we don't just get automatically zapped up to heaven as soon as we invite Jesus into our life. God has a plan and a purpose for us here on earth. We are to be in the world, not of the world, but we are called to be in the world. Now, think about this. John chapter 17, this is Jesus talking about his disciples. He says, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify, which means set apart. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Guess what? We have been sent into the world. We are not here just to coast along. We are here to be sent into the world. What did Jesus do while he was here on earth? He shared the good news. He showed love to people. He hung out with sinners. He hung out with people that needed hope. We are called to do the same thing. We have got to be constantly passionate about doing what Jesus did. Keeping the fire lit takes some intentionality. There's so many amazing stories of amazing people here in our church that have stories just like the one I'm about to tell. But the one that comes to most mind to mind that I heard most recently is Steve Mallory. He's our chairman of the deacons. He was telling me the other day that he had a medical procedure recently, and he had to do some physical therapy for it. And so while he was at physical therapy one day, he just started talking to the lady who was facilitating his physical therapy. And somehow, he directed the conversation towards Jesus. And right then and there, in that medical office, the physical therapist knelt down and invited Jesus into her life. That takes some intentionality. That takes some passion. There's so many more of you that have that passion to share Jesus with people. It allows us to stoke the fire in our own lives, and of course, as a church, which brings us to the next law that we're going to make sure is in our fire, right? This is what God called us to do, right? Put logs on the fire. Maybe we got to rearrange it a little bit. There you go, because it's a big fire, right? We've got to have constant presence. We've got to have constant presence. God desires an audience with you. God wants you to be in his presence. He wants a personal and intimate relationship with you. Think about it like this, class. What happens to a fire when you go to bed at night? You come back the next morning. What do you find? Ashes. The fire is out, right? Or maybe if you're lucky, there's a few little embers, but for the most part, the fire has gone out. When you leave, when your presence is withdrawn, we can miss God's presence. If we are not in his presence, then we miss what he wants to present to us. Imagine if the priests walked away. Imagine if they maybe fell asleep and they thought to themselves, you know what? You know, this is hard and this is not worth it. And they walked away. What would happen? The fire would go out. The divine flame would no longer be. The Bible says in James chapter 4, verse 8, come near to God and he will come near to you. God desires our presence. But as this verse tells us, it's going to require something on our end. We have to go to God's presence. We have to continue being intentional about being there. We have to be intentional about staying there. The decisions that we make in life are going to lead us towards the presence of God, or they're going to lead us away from the presence of God. And I can promise you this. Life in God's presence is so much more satisfying and so much more fulfilling than you can possibly imagine. We have to be ushered into God's presence. So if you're joining us today and you would say, you know, I just, for whatever reason, I feel far from God. Or maybe you would say, there's been a point in my life where I've been closer to God than I am right now. Let me just encourage you for a moment. God is still there. He never left. We serve a God who has promised to never leave us, to never forsake us, to never abandon us. So no matter how far away we may wander, his presence is always waiting for us with open arms. We serve a God that loves us that much, but it is so much better to be in the presence. That's what these priests got to do by being in the presence of God. We're going to continue adding some logs to the fire. We've got to make sure that we are constantly practicing. We've got constant practice. You see, this book right here is full of some amazing truths. It is full of some amazing promises. It is full of some amazing opportunities to learn about God. But it is also full of some instructions. It is also full of some application steps. You see, this passage that we're talking about today was the Lord commanding Moses to share with the priests. He was giving them instructions. And these instructions were meant to call them to action. I believe God, through his book, calls us to action. We've got to be constantly applying what God has given to us. James chapter 1, again, practical Christianity is one of my favorite books in the Bible. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Everybody say it together. Do what it says. I love verses in the Bible like this. There really is no gray area on this one. Do what it says. We have to do what God says. And sometimes that's going to mean getting a little bit uncomfortable. Maybe sometimes that means we've got to try something new. We've got to do something different. Anybody love to grill? Anybody love to grill meat? Oh, I'm a big steak person. I love grilling meat. But when I'm talking about grilling meat in this context, I'm not talking about the new age thing where you go, you plug the little probes into your steak and it's Bluetooth. You go sit on the couch for like 30 minutes and it dings. Whenever it's done, you just go take it off. No, I'm talking about the cutout of an oil bin, right? Like the guys that I saw on my way home yesterday. They were just cooking over that open flame. Yeah, I can hear your stomachs growling from the back row. But cooking over that open flame where it's hot and it's sweaty and you're greasy and you've got the fat and it's dripping. It's a dirty business, grilling. And I've got to imagine that that's probably what these priests who were called to fulfill these commands experienced. It was dirty. It was greasy. It was uncomfortable. Somebody had to take the 3 a.m. shift. Sometimes we're going to have to get a little bit uncomfortable in order to apply what God has done. And I don't know about you, but I'm grateful to be a part of a church that is willing to get uncomfortable so that other people can get comfortable with the relationship with Jesus. For 121 years, our church has been willing to get uncomfortable, to share the love of Christ, to by faith do whatever it takes to make Christ known, whatever it takes. That's the fun part, whatever it takes. You know, we as a church, we do something every year. It's a little thing singing Christmas tree. You guys know what I'm talking about? We do something called the singing Christmas tree. And it's a huge opportunity that we have to show people about Jesus. And I want to invite you for a moment to push the rewind button with me. And we're going to rewind. We're going to rewind nearly 50 years ago before the first singing Christmas tree. I got to imagine this is how it went. There's some church leaders sitting around in a circle. Some of you may have been there. We're sitting around in a church circle talking about, you know, what are we going to do for this Christmas season? And somebody piped in and said, hey, you know what? I got an idea. Let's build this contraption that kind of looks like a Christmas tree. Maybe we'll wrap it in Christmas lights and we'll have a bunch of people stand on it and we'll sing. I got to think there are a few people in the meeting thinking to themselves, this guy's lost it. No way. But aren't you grateful that our church decided to get a little uncomfortable, to put into practice, and started to stoke the fire? And now we have this amazing tradition. We got to make sure we are constantly practicing. And we have to practice what we preach, right? And so we've got to have a constant partnership. Throw the log on the fire. We've got to have constant. It's a lot louder than I expected it to be. But we've got to have constant partnership. See, these instructions that were given to these Levitical priests, that were not given to just one person. It was Aaron and his sons. It was a team of people. Guess what? You're on a team. We're a team. We get to partner together to encourage each other. As a church, we are meant to band together to stoke this fire. It's not all on one person. We get to come together. As individuals, as believers, as followers of Jesus, we get to encourage one another. Anybody ever remember a time, don't raise your hands, but remember a time where maybe it felt like your flame maybe died down a little bit? I can promise you this. Look around this room right now, those of you joining us online. Look around. There are so many people here in this God's house that would love nothing more than to come alongside you and throw some logs in your fire. To give you some encouragement, to give you some help, to give you exactly what you need to be used by God. That's the gift that we all have. If God wanted us to be individuals, He would have made it that way. But He made us in community. And I'm grateful to be a part of this amazing community. You guys are all so loving. If you think about it like this, it kind of reminds me of the story of Moses, and the Israelites were attacked by the Amalekites, and essentially what happens is Moses goes up on a hill, and he, whenever he raises his hands, the Israelites win. But as soon as his hands start dropping, the Israelite army starts losing. That's a lot of pressure, right? Anybody ever tried to hold your hands up like this for a long time? Yeah, it's hard. So what happens? Moses is up on this hill, and he's struggling a little bit. Two of his teammates noticed what was happening. Aaron and her, they walk up on the hill and said, hey, Moses, let me help you. Let me help you shoulder that burden for a minute. And they literally held his hands up so that the Israelite army would be victorious. I can promise you this, if you need help holding your hands up, somebody in this room, how loving our church is, they would love nothing more than to come alongside you and help stoke that fire. The last thing that we're going to talk about today in stoking our fire, if we want to see God continue to not extinguish in our lives, we've got to be in constant prayer. We've got to be in constant prayer. You see, prayer is a gift. These people that we're talking about in Leviticus, they didn't have the gift of prayer. But we do. We get the chance to converse with our Maker. To converse with the one who loved us, and that was to send his son Jesus to die on the cross. 1 Thessalonians says this in verse 5, or chapter 5, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:6, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. That's another practical one here. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need. Thank Him for all He has done. We as a church have an entire service dedicated to praying and praising God. You talk about stoking a fire, keeping a fire burning. Come join us on Wednesday nights. Come spend some intentional time praying. We've all got situations that are going on in our lives that could use some prayer. We're a team. Let's pray together. Let's be constantly in prayer for one another. Let's be constantly in prayer for what God has for us. You see, this fire right here, big fire, this fire right here represents our need of a Savior. You see, the sacrificial system was a long-term solution. God recognized, hey, I got to do something different. And he sent his son Jesus to live a perfect life, to die a sacrificial death on the cross, finally, once and for all, paying the sin debt. And we don't have to live under this sacrificial system anymore because of what God did. He lit a fire in our own individual hearts. And I believe he is challenging us, he is calling us to continue stoking that fire. Do you remember when God lit the fire in your heart? If you're joining us today and you've never experienced that, you've never invited Jesus into your life, started that relationship with him, accepted what he did for us on the cross. We're going to pray in just a moment. I'm going to lead you an opportunity to do that. But, you know, as we begin this worship experience, you know, earlier, we sang a song called Keep Me in the Moment. And as we get ready to leave this place in just a little bit, or maybe you're going to close off your browser window or turn off the TV, go on about our day, I want to encourage us to allow the words of this song to become our prayer. Lord, keep me in the moment. Help me live with my eyes wide open, because I don't want to miss what you have for me. God is doing amazing things here. Oh Lord, show me what matters. Throw away what I'm chasing after. I don't want to miss what you have for me. Lord, keep me in the moment. I believe God is challenging us to be in this moment. He has chosen us to be in this moment to keep the fire. Jesus, we are grateful for the work that you did on the cross. God, we are grateful for the opportunity for salvation. And if there's anybody in here today who has yet to make a decision to follow you, God, I pray that right now, as you are reaching out to them, you are knocking on their heart's door, God, that you would help them answer. If you're here today and you are ready to make a decision to follow Jesus, I'm going to lead you in a prayer in just a moment, but it's not any kind of magic words that make this happen. It's a true and genuine belief in your heart to say yes to Jesus. It's not a prayer between you and me. It's not a prayer between you and the person you came with. This is between you. To accept that flame that Jesus wants to light in your heart, you can just say something along these lines between you and God. Lord, I admit that I am not perfect. I am a sinner. I mess up. But I want to invite you to light a fire in my heart tonight. I want to invite you today. I want to invite you into my life. I believe that you sent your son Jesus to die on a cross. I believe that he paid the ultimate price. He was the ultimate sacrifice. And today, I commit my life to you. us, I pray that, God, you would help us continue to stoke the fire, not only here at First Sarasota, God, but to stoke the fire in our own hearts, that we would remain in your presence, we would praise you, we would practice what you have called us to do, we would stay in prayer, we would partner with each other. But to see what you have been doing here in this place continue for another 120 more years and beyond. God, we love you. And we are grateful for what you have done in